السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته dear colleagues and friends. Hope that you are all doing well and safe. Now, it's only 1 week before your exam. What you need to do is to trust your preparation. Stay calm and confident, please. You need to tackle each question with confidence. As I mentioned before, the stress is your first enemy. The stress will affect your performance in the exam, whatever your level. Believe in your abilities and remember, you are more than capable of succeeding, inshallah. So, good luck for you all in the next week. Because of the shortage in the time, and there is no possibility to arrange a session for the new recalls, I will keep posting some of the videos explaining the tasks which we did not explain before during the course. One of these tasks is the post-operative pulmonary embolism, which was a risk management task. I posted it in the group and I posted it in the PDF. I will update it today because some new informations are added to the drive or are added to the task. So if you review it after listening to this recording, you will find all the informations updated there. The risk management is a problem for the candidates who are not used to this type of our practice. So this task was a structured discussion task. Here the instructions or the domains to be tested, the communication with colleagues, patient safety, and applied clinical knowledge. You are the ST5 in the post-operative ward. You will have a meeting with the risk management lead, which will be the examiner here. He will take you through a case-based discussion about 44 years old woman who had pulmonary embolism in the third day after hysterectomy and bilateral salpingophorectomy for endometrial hyperplasia due to heavy menstrual bleeding. From the information given, the surgery was uneventful with no complications intraoperative. The history of the patient, she's a smoker. She's morbidly obese, body mass index is 42, and she's allergic to doxycycline. According to the information I got, there was pre-operative VTE risk assessment sheet, which was not filled. Means there is a deficiency here in the filling or in assessment of the VTE risk for the patient. There was a copy of the observation sheet, news chart, and inpatient drug sheet, and some candidates also mentioned that there was additional operation notes about the case, which everything was normal in these notes. So the questions which were asked in this task, which you are going to answer it today, include, give me a summary about the case. What are the additional information you need to know about it? And as we mentioned before, if you are a competent candidate leading the discussion, you will mention what are the additional information in the point of assessment without being asked or prompted by the examiner. Then you need to identify the risk factors which contributed to the development of the pulmonary embolism. And actually, this is the first step in the risk management, which is risk identification. Then the next steps of risk management to identify or to treat the condition and how you can avoid this happening in the future. So as I mentioned, there was a VTE risk assessment form which was not filled. So this is the first risk or the first contributing factor that may lead to her condition. There was a news chart which was showing gradual deterioration of the condition of the woman, which was deteriorated mainly in the third day. Maybe you'll find additional information that the patient was improved, because as I got the information telling that the patient now is okay and she's ready for discharge. So the first day, the news score was 3. The patient was well, stable vital signs. She was not ambulated yet. The saturation is normal. The abdomen is soft and lax, and she was in epidural catheter. There are risk factors here, delayed ambulation and epidural catheter, which will lead also to reduced mobility. The second day, the patient also was stable and the news score is 3. The saturation was normal but less than yesterday. Now she is in painkiller only pain relief, so the epidural catheter is removed. There is no information here about the ambulation of the patient. The third day, the patient was unwell, shortness of breath, and sudden onset of chest pain. The vital signs now are unstable, and the saturation dropped to 80%. The rapid response team was called. The patient was resuscitated and shifted to the HU. The CTBA showed symptoms or signs suggestive of pulmonary embolism. The patient started therapeutic low molecular weight heparin, and she is now stable and planned for discharge. Yeah, actually, this will be very early discharge if the patient was diagnosed in the third day and discharged in the same day. So I don't think this will be applicable in the task, but these are the information that I collected from the candidates. Also, there was a drug sheet. It will be same like this one, where you will find that the patient received the antibiotics, received the painkillers, but in the part of the anticoagulant or Clexan, the patient was given the doses in the first day, but suddenly there was no documentation if she received additional doses in the second or the third day or no. So these are the information that were provided in this task. So you have a general idea now about the task. So now the first question by the examiner was, give me a summary about the case. As I mentioned before, give me a summary means I'm testing your ability to hand over the cases. Now I will be your consultant and you are going to tell me what is the case, how you are going to hand over a case for your colleague or your consultant. So the SPAR form, always be very composed and very organized in the SPAR form. So the situation, what is the situation now? The situation is post-operative pulmonary embolism. What is the background? This is a 44 years old patient in the third day post TAH and PSO for a typical endometrial hyperplasia. She is non-smoker and morbidly obese. Body mass index is 42. She developed pulmonary embolism in the third day. It was managed in the HDU by anticoagulant, and now the patient is stable and there is a plan for discharge. Now the assessment. Now you here in the assessment, you will mention what are the last observations for the patient, and you will ask for additional information, as I mentioned before, to be a competent candidate leading discussion, avoiding many prompts here. So you will mention that the patient now is stable according to the last observation, and she's planned for discharge, but I need to know more information. This information plan or to put the follow-up plan, which will be under care of multidisciplinary team. And we need also to plan for risk management to avoid this complication to happen in the future. So this will be the summary about the case. In the part of assessment, we will add what are the additional information for risk identification. This is actually the first step in risk management, is to identify the risk. To identify the risk means you need to identify what went wrong, means what were the risk factors that lead to pulmonary embolism here. So we need to know the history. We need to review her notes, pre-operative and post-operative notes. We need to know if she's having any other medical conditions like thrombophilia, for example, any medications received before the surgery, like combined pills or tranexamic acids, if there is in a past history or family history of thrombosis, which type of anesthesia used during the surgery, what was the duration of the surgery? If we used this talking anti-pneumatic compression during the surgery as a prophylaxis, if the patient was properly hydrated pre and post-operative, and what was the ambulation status of the patient post-operative? The patient has a primary and secondary assessment for her risk for VTE and why it was not documented in her VTE risk assessment sheet, and the reason for missing the Clexan dose in the sheet. These are the information from the history. From the examination, we need to know her current vital signs. We need to examine her abdomen and abdominal wound and the suitability of the patient for discharge. So these are the additional information that I need to know about the patient to be able to put a plan for follow-up and a plan for risk management. Now, the second question or the third question, which was mentioned by the candidates, is how to identify the risk factors which contributed to the development of pulmonary embolism. There are many risk factors here in this case mentioned already in the candidate instruction, and there are additional risk factors that needs to be discovered by risk identification from history and from examination. To identify the risk, we have two models in the risk management, either the FIMIA model, or this is what's called failure mode and effective analysis model. In this model, we are going to examine the process in every step. Then we will identify what went wrong. This is called the failure modes. And what are the effects or the consequences of failure? And then we are going to identify the contributing factors. These contributing factors will be rated. We will rate the severity of the contributing factor. Then we will identify a controls or steps to prevent and reduce this risk. And finally, we are going to use the rating that we did in the contributory factors to decide which risk factor to be accepted in the system and which risk factor that needs to be treated. And based on this, we will decide an action plan. This is the failure mode and effective analysis model. Another model for identification of the risk is to use the fishbone analysis model. There are many elements that may contribute to the risk here. It may be in the human power or human resources, in the material, which means the supplies and the resources. It may be in the facilities and equipment. It may be in the method or the surgery itself. It may be due to environmental factors or lack of quality control. So to be specific in this case, there are patients factor. From the history, the age of the patient here is a risk factor. Her body mass index is a risk factor. She is smoker is another risk factor. And we need to add any identified risk factor from the history, like ambulation after the surgery, pre and post-operative hydration. So this can be considered the patient factors. A method factor, which means the hysterectomy itself. This is a major pelvic surgery, which was done for a pre-malignant or malignant condition, which increases the risk. We need to know what was the duration of the surgery and if there was any intraoperative complication or intraoperative bleeding. So these are the method factors. Now coming to the facilities and equipment factors, we need to identify why low molecular weight heparin was missed or not documented in the notes. Till now, we need to ensure if it was actually missed or it's not only documented in her drug observation part. We need to know how the medications were stored, if there was adequate supply of the blood thinner or the anticoagulant and the stocking itself, and VTE risk assessment form, why it's not filled, why the patient did not have primary and secondary risk assessment. And we need also from the facilities and equipment check the functions of the pneumatic compression and if it was used during and post-operative or no. Another factor is the manpower and environmental factors. This unit may be a busy unit with a staff overload, lack of training on the VTE risk assessment and treatment. We need to check if there was a problem with the communication and if the SPAR tool was used or no, because these communication problems may lead to missed anticoagulant or proper documentation of anticoagulant, which was already given. So this is how to identify the risk, what are the models to identify the risk, and what are the contributory factors that can be considered here in this case that leads the woman having post-operative pulmonary embolism. Start the risk management plan. Here, the risk management is a quality tool. It is designed to detect, monitor, to assess, mitigate, and prevent the risk to the patients. There are four basic questions or four basic steps in any risk management. The first step is risk identification. What could go wrong? What could go wrong? The second step is risk analysis and evaluation. So here we need to know what be the impact of the mistakes that happened on the patient. Then the third step is the risk treatment. The risk treatment means what we can do to minimize the chances of this happening again in the future. The last step is risk control. The risk control means what we can learn from this experience to prevent things to happen in the future. So during the risk management of this case, we have to answer these four questions. We'll start by saying that any facility or any system, any medical system, there are safety barriers to protect the human from hazards. Each of these barriers will have inconstant weaknesses or inconstant holes, and that's why it is considered or it has a similarity to the Swiss cheese. So we developed Swiss cheese model that's used for analysis of the major accident and catastrophic system failures. So using or identifying the risk, the barriers will allow the stakeholder to close these weaknesses in the service by applying the principles of leadership, clinical and technical support, and training for the staff. So now we are going to mention what are the risk management steps in this case. So how to analyze the complication? As we mentioned before, remember the 7 Ds of the risk management. The first step in risk management is reporting. The incident reporting or DADX, it facilitates the local investigation. You are initiating an incident report to search for the possible causes of the complication, avoid this happening again in the future. Documentation, all the events has to be documented and recorded in a chronological manner to help the risk management team. Briefing, patient, family, members, and team, all the events has to be explained better by the most senior person or the consultant. If the patient is not happy with the explanation or she is not satisfied with the service, she has the right to complain. And here we will speak about the duty of Condor and the Pulse. The next step is discussions. Discussions means audits, means root cause analysis and reflective practice. The first step is to rate the risk. This post-operative pulmonary embolism is a near-miss event. Near-miss event means it is a serious life-threatening event. The patient may die. After risk rating, we are going to start audits and root cause analysis. So we are going to arrange a team, as we mentioned before in the audit. This team will collect the data. The collection of the data will be from the medical records or from interviews with the medical team. The data will be collected in a chronological manner to identify what were the shortcomings or the mistakes in the patient care and the contributory factors to her condition. So, risk rating, then audits and risk analysis. Then we have to analyze the data, testing these risk factors and implementation of the best solution to avoid this incident happening again. Once we reach the result, these results has to be evaluated and shared in meeting and discussions, and we need to agree a time scale to review the results and re-audit. The drills, we need to teach the staff how to do risk assessment. We need to improve the communication between different team members, especially at the time of handovers. Then the final step in the 7 Ds or in the risk management is to mention what are the discharge and red flag signs to seek for urgent help for this patient. We need to have plan for follow-up multidisciplinary team. This patient has to continue the anticoagulant for 3 to 6 months according to the hematologist plan, and this patient will need adequate support in terms of medical care and psychological support, and she has to be given contact numbers. So these are the steps of the risk management. We identified the risk, and we know how to identify the risk either by the FEMA model or the Fishbone model. Then we identified what are the contributory factors specific to this case. Then the second step after risk identification is a risk analysis. Risk analysis means we will analyze the effect of the condition or what went wrong and its effect on the patient. The third step is risk treatment. Risk treatment means we need to identify how to avoid this happening again in the future. And the final step is to use this plan in planning the safety of the other patients in the future to avoid this incident happening again. So the next question by the examiner, how to avoid this happening again in the future? Here, there is another model called the radical framework. The radical framework is a framework for management of risk in patients or in healthcare systems. The radical framework is abbreviation means raise awareness, design for safety, involve the users, collect and analyze the safety data, and learn from the patient safety incidents. So the first step from the radical is raise awareness. Here, we are promoting awareness and understanding of the patient safety by training and education, by leadership and team working, by risk management forums, communication strategies, and appraisals and accountability. To raise awareness, we will go to the second step, which is design for safety. We have to design a safety module to protect the patient by standardized guidelines and protocols, effective communication using the SPAR tool, to do source management and care bundles, handovers, debriefing, and operating checklist. This is the second step of the radical framework. So raise awareness, design for safety. Third step is to involve the users by increasing the awareness of the hazards in care pathway, making the patient safety interventions, reporting the patient safety incidents, and feedback in safety of care. So raise awareness, radical means raise awareness, design for safety, and involving the users. Then the next step, collect and analyze. A safety culture measurements, prospective risk analysis, incident reporting, case note reviews, root code analysis, and benchmarking. Then the final step in the radical framework is to learn from incidents. We need to learn from the patient safety incidents and identify safety leadership at the board level, identify the patient safety indicators, the feedback from the risk analysis, evidence of learning from risk analysis, and how to develop safety interventions and safety culture, monitoring, and organizational, as well as team and individual learning. So this will be how to use the radical framework for management of risk in healthcare. Step first step is to raise awareness. Second step is to have a design for safety. Then we will involve the users to collect and analyze the data on safety of care. Then the final step is to learn from the patient safety incidents. How can we apply these steps on our case? This patient needs to have a clear instruction to avoid the use of HRT and oral pills. Any further data or any further surgery better to be used or better to be done by minimal invasive surgery if possible, and following the enhanced recovery program to identify the risk of the patient. Be operative. Each patient should have a clear VTE risk assessment. Better to postpone the surgery if not urgent, till reducing or optimizing hair health by reducing smoking and stop reducing the weight and stop smoking before surgery, and application of prophylactic low molecular weight heparin protocols. These can prevent up to 60 to 70% of any further embolic episodes. Proper handover, documentation, and communication between the team members responsible for the patient care and involvement of the seniors and consultant and protocols for reviewing the prescribed medications and treatment plans. So if you are asked how to avoid this happening in the future, you will mention there is a radical framework for management of healthcare to avoid any safety incidents to occur in the future. This radical framework, including raising awareness of the staff, and there should be a design for safety to involve the users in the safety plan, to collect and analyze any data on the safety of care, and then learning from the incidents. So in this case, we learn from experience that it's better to avoid this surgery before optimization of the general condition of the patient, and it is general to be done through minimal invasive surgery, preoperative risk assessment and preoperative optimization, application for protocols of low molecular weight heparin prophylactic that reduce the embolic episodes, proper documentation and proper handover and communication between the staff using the SPAR tool, involvement of the seniors, consultant and protocols for reviewing the medication and the treatment plan. This patient should be advised on her post-operative follow-up and long-term plans like avoidance of HRT and oral contraceptives in the future, which will increase her risk, and regarding her follow-up with the hematologist and the plan to continue the low molecular weight heparin or the anticoagulant in the future. I have added also a list which are suggesting or suggested trigger list for the incident reporting in maternity and in gynecology cases, because we had so many questions in the group asking if this incident will initiate an incident reporting or no. So there is two suggested trigger list for incident reporting in obstetrics and gynecology. I added it in the PDF. So this is quick explanation how to go through this task. In this task, what you need to mention, what are the risk management steps, the four steps of risk management, how to identify the risk, how to analyze it, how to treat it, and how to reduce the risk in the future. This is the main issue of the task. You will speak in general, then you will specify each step regarding to the case, how to identify the risk using the FEMIA model or the fishbone model, and how to use the radical framework to prevent this happening in the future. So I hope it's clear now. If you find it useful, please remember me and my family in your prayers, and best of luck in your exams. Please keep the hard work. Absolutely, you can do it. Absolutely, you can do it. You have to visualize your success. Stay focused and take each question one step at a time. Please do not overload yourself by overthinking. Remember, you are equipped now with everything you need to master the exam and to pass in this exam. What you need now in the next few days is to keep a positive mindset and give it all your efforts. All the best, inshallah, in the next few days. And I will keep posting videos on the new recalls. Wish you all the best. Remember me and my family in your prayers, as you are in my prayers. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.